Oh, we weren't cutting the camera? Okay.
There it is. What's up, everybody? My name is Fang. Welcome to week number 4 or 5, I think, of the week 4 of the EGF Collegiate. I am Fang, joined here by the lovely Duramgar. We are here to deliver some nice collegiate smash action to you guys, produced by Mr. Devin 3000 of the House of 3000 crew. So I hope everyone's having a good Tuesday so far. Not bad outside. It's getting a little colder out there, so I hope you boys and girls are bundling up and getting ready to play some Smash Bros. Indoors. Mm-hmm. And what are we looking at here today, Dara?
That's a phenomenal question. I'm so glad that you asked. So today we have 4 matches ahead of us, 3 matches. I actually lied. We are going to be seeing DePaul University up against the University of Connecticut. Then we'll be seeing St. John's up against Wichita. And then finally, we'll be finishing off with Quinnipiac up against Fairfield University. We were supposed to have Georgetown up against University of Colorado today, but sadly, DQs happen, you know, such is the reality with brackets. It's inevitable. But yeah, the first matchup today is going to be DePaul up against University of Connecticut. And the first match will be ADR up against LK. I can't say I personally recognize these players. How about you, Sean?
ADR and LK, I haven't, not too familiar with, but I believe what happened with UConn last week, because I do remember we did see them play. They barely did not manage to clutch it out against St. John's University last week, but they did have some very strong players that looked really, really good. However, DePaul has kind of been snapping lately, I feel like. So I am very, very excited to see what they are going to pull out this week. I'm trying to see what they did last, what kind of damage they put out last week. It doesn't actually look like they played last week, in fact. So they might not have been within the rotation.
I'm not really 100% sure like how the rotation of the schools go, but we are going to be jumping into the first match shortly. And before then, I would like to just give you guys a couple of reminders. First and foremost, keep yourselves hydrated. I have here an absolutely gargantuan water bottle that I will be using to keep myself hydrated from now until about 11 p.m. So I highly recommend that you guys go do the same. I know how much you guys love the Monster energy drinks. Nuh-uh, that's not going to cut it. Preferably something without sugar, caffeinated. Definitely something without sugar. And number 2, guys, make sure to get up and stretch every now and then. Helps keep your blood, you know, circulating. Helps make sure that your muscles are nice and loose. And speaking of stretches, something I really recommend doing, guys, every time before you play, some hand stretches. Really, really nice at avoiding some, you know, lifelong medical complications, carpal tunnel, tendonitis. Heard of it? I have, and boy, oh boy, am I not a fan of it. So, you know, guys, it's really, really great. Get those fingers and joints really loose. Helps you game at peak capacity at all times. So you should get on that.
That's true. Keeps your, if you have a healthy body moving out, you also have a healthy mind moving into it. It is also, I believe, scientifically proven that if you're feeling better, you will also think better. You know, your brain will not be as sluggish. You'll be healthy. So, you know, maybe try to cut back on the energy drinks. Stick to some water. Prevents headaches and migraines and stuff like that. If you're staying hydrated, it's super duper important, especially at this crucial point in all of your lives. I believe we do see ADR and LK stepping up to the plate right now. So DePaul last time kind of slaughtered St. John, so they have not played since then. So I'm very, very curious to see if they're going to snap back with that type of aggression and power this time around. UConn has something to prove after their loss last week, so if they can take it over DePaul, it'll be looking pretty goddamn good for them, I'd say.
So you were saying that DePaul last week, like, it was like a slaughterhouse? Like,
So 2 weeks ago, they had to fight against St. John's, who they crushed completely. Okay. I believe the score was 26-6, so it was... They were the highest scorer of that week as well. Yeah. So... kind of nutty.
That's quite a brutal victory. That's definitely up in there.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, I'm not really sure what to hold up as, you know, banning stages and all that. And once again, guys, this is a modified Haku battle format. And for those of you guys that are uninitiated, so basically you might be familiar with a coup battle, which is when two players go off against each other, three stocks, whoever wins has the remaining stocks transferred over to the next match. It doesn't work like that here. So what basically happens is for every game that you win, you earn your school the amount of points equal to the amount of stocks that you have left. And if you win the best of three with your opponent, you will be earning an extra 2 points. So the most you could win at once, 8 points. You could get a double three stock and 2 points to close out the set. The least that you can do, 4 points. Either way, this means that, you know, even if it's inevitable that a school will lose to another, by the end of it, every single point matters by the end of the season because it's important for something, I believe.
And yeah, so both schools, DePaul being based out of the Windy City of Chicago, and of course UConn being based in the wonderful state of Connecticut. So both of these schools have a lot of regional pride on the line, something to prove to each other, you know. Within the U.S., schools especially always scrap, and it doesn't have to just be through sports. It can also be through Smash or esports. So they're trying to prove something. They're trying to prove they're superior to the rest of the schools. Anyway, I think we're about to get into it. So let's see what this first match has for us.
Music to my ears, that game ready. But click A. Oh, thank goodness. Whenever the match starts, you know, the anticipation builds. So we are now going to be seeing LK up against DKADR. Zelda versus Pac-Man. This is not something I've seen particularly recently. Pac-Man can't probably play as back as he would normally like to, and would have to kind of be aggressive, which is not something that you often see from such a freestyle trap kid.
Oh boy. And yeah, I do agree with that. However, I do think Pac-Man has the frame data to kind of just get a lot of quick aerials in there and scrap with Zelda once he is in. So it's going to be up for LK to kind of just keep ADR away from them as much as they can. And already we're seeing LK getting a little something started up here and kind of anticipating ADR's approaches and just using Zelda's amazing grab game to get Pac-Man off of her.
Okay, now both of them are just like really painting this patiently. Good up B, just punishing Pac-Man, over committing to, you know, like just smacking that Hydra off the stage. Nicely done. No out of shield punish. I'm not sure if Pac-Man could have gotten neutral or perhaps was trying to go for something a little bit better there. F-Smash, well, it's not going to kill from the other side of the stage. How is he going to be able to get off the ledge? And look at that little walk that he did.
That is one thing you have to be careful out of shield against Zelda. She has amazing dashback F smash, just the way that she shifts her entire body. So you have to be very, very careful when doing aerials, leaning into her out of shield. You're probably most likely better off either trying to just dash away or maybe just wait and not overcommit right there, because you know you will get caught up in your movement sometimes. And this grab game from LK right now is really, really working out super duper well for the ball right now.
Nice little juggle, tries to go through the extension, but, you know, overextend there. Can't be whipping those uppies. Like, you know, at some point, it's like an option that your opponent is going to anticipate and position themselves. And Oiden to be able to punish, not able to actually get anything off of that Oiden, really, really unfortunate for ADR. Pac-Man can definitely get a lot off of his, like, rising and falling aerials. He just hits the hell out of his.
Yeah, and it seems like LK is doing such a good job of baiting ADR in. They just cannot seem to breach past this wall of Phantom.
You see ADR fall out of the F-Smash and then proceed to punish LK for it? That's not something I've seen too often, but you know what? I'm going for it.
Okay. Yeah, LK doing such a good job of just keeping the space right now from ADR. ADR just can't seem to breach past this Phantom Zone, and as soon as LK realizes that they're in danger, they just dash back to play another Phantom, and they're good to go. I do think ADR should be trying to break zone a little bit more using Pac-Man's projectiles. I know Zelda has a reflector built into her kit as one of her quickest options. However, it's still nice to threaten the option sometimes. That's such an unfortunate miss on the F smash right there.
Yeah, like, literally just but ADR is definitely having all the right ideas. I love the little adjustments that they started to make at the ledge. They whipped it in front of the shield. You know, they didn't make it on the punch at all. We just whipped it and faded out the option. They were able to punish it, especially with extension 50.64%. Galaxian. That move is just insane.
Oh my god.
Huh.
It's so scary right now. Both these guys are on last stock. Duking it out. It seems like though LK just had better control, but ADR just brought it all the way back so quickly.
He really had the idea, caught LK jump but once again, a little bit. Oh!
Wow, what a comeback from ADR right there. Just catching one of these recoveries from LK. Just being more patient, and that's what you have to do against Zelda. You have to wait and shield a lot of the time, because most of her mix-ups on her recovery, is she going to go to ledge or is she going to try to hit you? Those are pretty much the only two options I see a lot of Zelda players go for. And there is a considerable amount of end lag on the end of that recovery right there. And ADR just did a really good job of staying in shield, respecting the range of the Phantom right there, and found his way in so, so well. That was really, really well played from ADR right there.
Yeah, that was like such an aggressive recovery option. And it wouldn't have even killed at that point, I believe. Also, ooh, nice little slow-mo. I couldn't even tell you what happened there.
I think he deployed it. I think he either did it way too early, or there might just be like a little blind spot in the startup of that F smash right there. But either way, Aidenar making a massive comeback right there and just managing to just keep
LC off. This is like Pac-Man at 23%. Looking at the trajectory of Zelda, I will say it looked a little bit ambiguous as to whether or not they're going to go to ledge for this. But you know what? I do really appreciate the fact that ADO just sat there, respected it, didn't go too greedy with like a two-frame punish, and was able to get the kill off. So LK going into game two, I think they started off really, really strong when they were playing back, playing defensively. But then at a certain point, as soon as they lost that stock lead, I feel like they got very greedy with some of their approaches. You saw things like full hop down air, full hop double jump down air, you know? And ADR was like, okay, I'm going to dash back F smash you because you're holding forward sometimes.
And I think LK could have probably recovered a bit more safely. You know, there aren't a lot of options that Pac-Man has to catch Zelda on the ledge most of the time. So those recoveries, especially at kill percent, are like incredibly risky to go for if you're going to go for an aggressive recovery with Feroar's Wind as Zelda. Kind of handing ADR that game right there, but we'll see if ADR can keep up the momentum or if LK is going to snatch it right back from him. Because it's only 1 point differential right now, so.
Yeah, 1 point difference, honestly, especially at the start, pretty much negligible. With too much ooh, I liked a bit of a hydro mix up instead of going through like the regular follow up, recognizing that they were off stage. Had to mix it up a little bit.
Ooh. Okay, ADR kind of cooking. Starting to chef up a little bit with these setups right here. It's Pac-Man. I like that ADR has now opted for throwing way more projectiles. I think it's keeping LK on his toes a lot more. And because of that, I think ADR is finding a lot of mileage off of keeping Zelda in this advantage here.
I think most people, I just saw this again from ADR, and I feel like it's happened before, where they just sort of dash back and try to get an S-match. And by the way, what a phenomenal parry. It's not easy to get like multi-hit parry punishes, especially to do something as control as an S-match afterwards. That was pretty famous. That's ADR.
Okay. And I like ADR just respecting the Phantom range right here. Knowing that Pac-Man isn't really a character, especially with the lead who has to go in all the time, I like how he's been waiting for his opening a majority of the time. And I feel like LK is going to have to start mixing it up just a little bit with either the Phantom placement or how they're going to catch ADR on the back foot right now. Ooh, boy.
That was so dangerous. I was so close to just going south so quickly. But I'm glad that LK was able to fight the way out of it. And again, these upbeats are neutral, not doing LK any favors once again. It's sort of, you know, that time they were able to land, but every time they extend.
Oh my god, yeah. ADR just kind of going ham right now on LK. LK kind of just getting caught on these recoveries a lot. I think they're just scared to go to ledge, or they're just missing their angles a little bit. But now that ADR has the lead, he doesn't really need to approach whatsoever. He can kind of just hang back, charge up his fruit. This is where Pac-Man starts bringing the game down to his pace.
Once you have such a huge deficit against Pac-Man, you can
always feel a hole.
It's really, really
cool. Oh no! Yeah, he's dead.
pollution. Oh. That's probably just going to be like a neutral outage and drift out. Yeah. Just like a slight flub on the input today, but no worries. Just still 100%. The name, once again, like LK, getting so greedy with two attempts to initiate that KBO was just like, okay, I'm going to dash my gas cash again.
And I'm loving the space that ADR is putting between LK right now. It's kind of forcing LK to almost approach a majority of the time, because if you can't get anything started with Phantom and you're down, you got to start approaching. And this combo game right now from ADR, almost nailing the stock right there off of LK. That was a magnificent combo string right there using the apple.
Never sleep on Pac-Man's local sentences, because they will like jump you up to like absurd lengths really, really quickly. Once again, I don't even think that up smash would have killed at 76. Either way, like, LK, he's teleported angle. He's up the angle. Very, very tough.
It seems like ADR kind of figured out LK's game plan a little bit and has found out what exactly to be punishing LK on right now. Ooh. Oh, he did the That was so cool. Oh, yeah. ADR just inside LK's head. That just seems like LK got very, very overwhelmed once ADR started pulling out the tricks and started pulling out the fruits. That was insane.
Yeah, that was definitely a little bit wild. I feel like towards the end, especially, like, LK was like, that sort of just looks ridiculous just because
that
of
was
how
so cool.
It is moving. Yeah.
As Chad is pointing out, it's definitely an F smash combo video for ADR, but for good reason. I feel like LK was serving up a little bit of an unfortunate SD right there, given that Pac-Man does have one of the longer end lags when it comes to air dodges. But really, really good stuff to ADR. Like, totally reversed and adapted super duper quickly after that game one. So that's going to be setting up DePaul really, really nicely.
Yeah, pretty nice, pretty set off. It's already going to be 5-0, I believe, leading 2 points with a 2-stock lead, 1 point from the first game. And then from taking home that set, 2 extra points. That's 5-0 for the call so far. Yeah, I feel like in the beginning, I feel like every Zelda, like, has, like, you know, their own, like, way that they like to play and their own, like, setups that they have that are very specific and personal to them. And once you're able to adapt to that, once you're able to understand a little bit of what they're looking for, you know, you can just sort of kind of slowly start to pick apart the game plan. You know, like, the key to being, like, a really dynamic and, like, difficult to punish Zelda is like, you know, being able to have different sets, being able to sort of trap and control the opponent's movement. But I feel like as soon as LK's game plan was starting to get shut down, we saw very aggressive, very antsy approaches. And ADR was just able to consistently land those punishes. So really, really good stuff to them. I think they killed it.
Hell yeah. They did really, really good. I think the adaptation was super, super snap heavy. Really, really good stuff right there from ADR. LK, I'd like to see a little bit more mixing up from. Try to nail those recoveries just a little bit better, like practice them, try to angle them towards ledge or something like that, you know. Go into training mode for literally just like 15 minutes and just nail that shit out.
Some of those angles definitely didn't feel like they were trying to be aggressive with it. It didn't feel like they always had intended to go into Pac-Man shield. Like, especially with the first game, like how like they teleported right onto Pac-Man shield. And like their trajectory, it felt like they were trying to go snap onto the ledge. Mm-hmm. But yeah, either way, always something to be really, really mindful of. It's a really good mix-up, but that's what it is. It's a mix-up. You know? If you're constantly going for it, then it just becomes the option that you're doing over and over. And it's extremely exploitable. Mm-hmm. So the next match that we will have up, I believe, is going to be between Bobby Time and Wukong.
Ooh. I know Wukong we saw last week. I believe they played Bowser, if I recall correctly. I'm not too sure who Bobby Time plays, though.
Yeah, neither am I. Wukong, Bowser. I feel like we've seen quite a bit of Bowser's in the Collegiate League so far. He seems to be pretty popular among the youths. Could it be me, though?
We're going to see what happens here. I believe we're getting right into the match as I hear that ready in my little eardrums. So let's see what happens here. Let's see if UConn can kind of snap back against DePaul. And we got Bobby Time playing Pokemon Trainer. Okay, so definitely the Mon I'm probably going to see here is... I feel like Ivysaur...
It's Bowser. This feels like a touch of death, honestly. If Bowser loses Ninja once, how much is Tennessee taking? All of it. How much stage is he losing? All of it. But falling out of that back is going to be crunch.
Yeah, this is what Squirtle pretty much wants. He is the startup combo king. He manages to get it on heavies very, very easily, secures that grab, and will do just those basic bread and butter combos that we're so used to seeing. And then once the percents get a little more kill percent-y for Bowser, we're going to see the switch to Ivysaur like we just saw right now. And okay, or Charizard. I feel like all three Mons are very, very well equipped to deal with everything that Bowser has in his kit, especially since I feel like Pokemon Trainer is a pretty good heavy slayer.
Yeah. Absolutely. You have like the local setting up, like one of the most perfect hedgehogs in the game. You have somebody that can live to a few of those hands as well. It's just going to be up to Bobby to be able to get that stock off, which is always the real challenge. When you're always fighting Bowser, Polito is not going to be able to take it right yet. Goes for the Bowser grab, thanks for a little bit of extra damage. Ooh. That will be the one to take it. Bobby Time looking like a Vitamix. Kind of blinding right now.
Oh my god, yeah. So it seems like Bobby has this matchup already down to a bit of a science. Just trying to get Bowser to around 80-ish percent so that Ivysaur's aerials can start working really well. Plus, we are getting commentation from our stream runner, or rather our technical director, that PT is kind of OD in this matchup. So it's definitely going to be an uphill battle for Wukong just a little bit. I feel like they're going to have to use Bowser's large size and excellent ledge trapping to kind of just keep Bobby at bay like we're seeing right now. Neutral might be a little bit more of a toss-up for them.
But what a high recovery option. Being able to get past what Bowser does most and suddenly it is Bowser at the ledge. Neutral got it, right? That at home.
Oh wow, that
giant up. That was
some nice triangle DI. I was gonna say that was some Bermuda Triangle DI right there. My mind ripped his stick off his controller and threw it away. That being said though, Bobby's momentum not being slowed up whatsoever from that.
That hit all the way up through the platform.
Wukong is keeping on the aggression right now. It just seems like this Bobby's favorite Mon to be using in this matchup seems to be Zard. This Zard is kind of schmooing right now in a very, very unfortunate FP to tie off game one right there. But oh my god, the momentum from Bobby. Holy moly. That was so quick. Okay. I mean, it was aggressive. He said, I have to do homework tonight. I want to go to the dining hall, maybe. Link up with some friends. I don't got time for this, Bowser.
That's unfortunate, too. And like, they were just starting to chef a little bit as well.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, such an unfortunate attack like that. They weren't shielding as much as they could be. They were, I don't know, I just feel like they're really, really close. They weren't expecting a lot of the Mon's burst ranges. And they weren't playing like too defensively. Granted, they didn't get too many coin flips to actually like play neutral with, right? They get hit once and suddenly they're gonna blend into the offstage. But, you know, in the few instances where it was a little bit slower, I do feel like they were pushing it a little bit too far, dashing it a little bit too much. And they were just, you know, they were just getting hit.
I think also Bobby's knowledge of like what spacing to respect on Bowser was like super good that game. Just using Zard, Bear, and F-Tilt to kind of poke out Bowser out of a range that Charizard normally wouldn't be comfortable of going in. And doing a really, really great job of just keeping Wukong out. I feel like Wukong is going to have to probably slow his game plan down just a little bit. You know, I know a lot of Bowser players do like to press the gas, but when Bowser does tend to take it a little bit slower, especially in matchups where he has to kind of worry about the amount of damage that can be done, like Pokemon Trainer, I feel like trying to dictate the pacing of the game more in your favor is definitely going to help find more openings and definitely restrict the amount of burst that PT is allowed to do on you. Rescue Wukong does.
I feel like many players have a tendency to try to match the opponent's pace rather than playing around it. Like, whenever you're like being put into blended by Fox, by like these really, really combo-heavy characters, it kind of makes you want to instinctively do the same thing they're doing. And that can often, more often than not, it can translate to pressing unnecessary buttons and disadvantage. And those definitely did not do Wukong any favors. So just as you said, you know, respecting PT's voice ranges a little bit more, just slowing down the game a little bit. And I think we're going to have a set.
So yeah, Wukong, they're probably just counterpicking the stage right now as they're getting ready. A lot of what Wukong looked like he was doing was promising. You know, he was just trying to do those uppies out of shield. Like, he was starting to slow it down just a little bit towards the end there, but I think he got a tad too overwhelmed by Bobby. And, you know, that can definitely, nerves can definitely lead into some SDs, you know, especially at this level of play. I feel like at the college level of play, a lot of players do not really go to tournaments too actively, so they're not really too used to tournament nerves outside of their own school's tournaments a lot of the time. So it can definitely get to you. You definitely have to just keep practicing, keep putting yourself in those high-pressure situations, and eventually you'll be able to manage the nerves just a little bit better.
Yeah, no, definitely. Dog, I've been competing for 3 years, and I still get nervous.
Yeah, same here. You know, if you're putting unfamiliar waters, you're definitely bound to get a little bit nervous. But regardless, heading into game two,
water that you've been into before, even if it's like kiddie pool dipping toes, I'll still get a little antsy about it. That being said, game two gonna be opting for Smashville. Sure, I guess Molly Blossom could help, but wow, look at this text on the top 5.
So I actually like this stage pick a lot for Wukong right here. There's less real estate for him to navigate in order to get to Bobby time. He doesn't have to worry about Bobby really resetting neutral too much, because look at how big Bowser is. When he's sitting center stage, he has a lot of options at his disposal in terms of positioning where he can go super duper quickly. And we're seeing that already. Bobby kind of struggling to get in a bit, already being forced to switch to Charizard to lengthen his lifespan just a little bit more.
This should be the stuff. Bobby time actually not going to be committing to anything. Just wanted to go for flame throw. I think that flame throw was a severe misplay. That was a Bowser off stage without a double jump. They could only recover from one direction. That should have been a free hitbox of any kind. But, you know, they just backed off the flame throw. And Bowser had a nice hitbox to cover them on the way up.
Yeah, it just seems like Bobby is now not respecting the range of Wukong enough, because he knows that pretty much if he backs off even a little bit, he's putting himself in the corner. I'm wondering why they decided to go to a stage this small. Trying to think about what else they probably could have been. I'm assuming maybe like Yoshi, something like that.
That was really, really tight.
Good poke right there. This is definitely Wukong's chance to try and get something started here. As Squirtle is out, meaning he's a light little baby, so one strong hit is going to take him out.
Didn't even feel like extending anything over that token. Dash back his head a little bit. I feel like right now, Bobby time, not only is he a good defense, but I feel like they get like so many hits at this point, but they're just kind of dashing back and resetting.
Yeah, one thing I do agree that Bobby could be standing his ground just a little bit more. I also feel like he should be going for grabs more, especially with Ivysaur. Like, it's clear that Wukong has been waiting in shield a lot of the time to get that up B with punish. But if your opponent's waiting in shield, just grab him. You know, don't let him put that bubble out without any repercussions. That being said, this game is even a very, very nicely. We're seeing some great adaptation from Wukong here. However, the Bobby time Squirtle is back on the field.
Gonna be a grab.
Oh my god!
Into the down smash. Tries to go to the stupid play mode. Normally that would suffer any other get up attack. That's about to. My lad has massive
balls. Oh yeah. The jab jab of any nature will not work on Bowser. At least at lower percents.
It depends. Some of the scale was not that tough, though.
Ooh. Okay. This is gonna be very, very crucial if Wukong can manage to take this game back. But as I say it,
The forwarder coming out from Bobby right there, securing DePaul. Another set right there. Still really, really good stuff to Wukong right there. Like, didn't make it easier for him that second game whatsoever.
Yeah. They
so unfortunate.
More confidently. But you know what? Just as he said, like, Bobby Time, like, just cleaned it up totally to the end.
And we saw there Wukong getting a little antsy in the corner right there, trying to just double jump in place, not really finding anything that could get him out of there. And tried to go for that F tilt. Kind of ran over Wukong that game one. But game two, a lot closer. And I think the stage pick had a lot to do with it and how Wukong was kind of managing his options and keeping on the pressure without backing off too much.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it's not, sometimes it's not enough.
Yeah, sometimes it's just about the Pokemon trading. I think this game, like, this game was a lot closer in particular because Bobby Time was just really, really not pushing the advantage as much as they could be sometimes.
It looked rough. Clean my room. Yeah, my room's a little bit of a mess right now, guys. Not gonna lie. I got a bunch of hot sauce in that box right there. I got my Halloween costume in the back over there. A bunch of other chapstick and a bunch of other junk. I haven't made my bed yet. It's a mess out here, you know? So you're right. A clean room is a clean mind. But if you do go to my stream, twitch.tv/fan9s, and I am streaming. I have a channel point goal of 500 points that will make me make my bed.
So are you serious?
I'm dead serious. You can go there right now, twitch.tv/fan9s.
So basically, check. I want you to think about the moral predicament that you just put the entirety of the chat into. If they don't go and tune into your stream, they are responsible.
They're responsible for not cleaning my room. That's basically it. So if you want me to clean my room, please follow me on twitch.tv/fan9s. You can also follow my lovely co-caster here at twitch.tv/Duramgaria. That is Duramgar IA. Really, really good Smash content coming from there as well. So if you guys like to see some Smash, we're putting it out there. You can also follow twitch.tv/8HO3K, or House of 3000 rather. twitch.tv/House of 3000 for great, amazing Smash content. They have tournaments every Wednesday showing off Tri-State's finest. They also have a open fight club, which is basically like a King of the Hill style thing on Sundays. So definitely make sure you check that out if you want to get some good practice in there. A lot of good players who show up to that week in and week out. Plus you get some snarky commentary from Devin and Ed Gang throughout it all as well, which is pretty fun. I've been a part of it. Good time.
Devin, our stream producing, whenever they do hop onto commentary, they tell you how it is. Okay, Devin, he'll tell you how it is. He'll tell you like what's really happening. He doesn't beat around the bush, okay? he doesn't fluff around the edges. Okay, Devin, if he sees something, he'll say it. It's some of the most interesting content out there.
Yeah, for sure. I think HO3K is probably the best in the business when it comes to Smash content. In terms of community engagement, I feel like they are really, it really just feels like you're not watching like a big organization stream. It feels like you're watching, you know, just another Smasher streaming, which is what you want. You want that relatability.
You want that feeling of closeness. You want to feel like you know them.
Exactly. Who are we getting up next? I believe we are getting Cookie and SHSP up, so we're going to be seeing Greninja versus I don't know what deck. I've never seen Cookie play before, but I'm sure they're good. They're very good at the video game.
I feel like I've seen SHSP before, but, you know, I'm afraid that the tag is not 100% familiar. Goodness, I feel like just like on the tip of my tongue too. Like I've just seen SHSP play.
Yes, last week you played Greninja.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Yeah. We saw them play against, I forget who, but
I know we did watch them last week. I think it might have been actually St. John. It was St. John. We saw SHSD fight against Ditko. I forgot what character Ditko played, but I know SHSD did a great job in clutching it out both times against them.
So we're going to see. We're going to see how that goes. Yeah.
So I don't know when they're going to get started, as in my sound has been deleted off the face of the earth, because Devin wants to ensure a quality stream for all of you out there, so God bless his soul. There are a lot of moving gears around, and sometimes that's hard for internet to work with. So we're going to be seeing them coming up pretty soon. So I'm very, very excited for that.
Yeah, I'm just going to be taking a look at what's happening at the other schools on the other stream, because course, this is a dual stream. If you aren't interested in what's happening with the other schools, you can also tune into twitch.tv/officialEGF. Over there, they have Marquette University up against William and Mary. You know, players that we've definitely seen here before, like Smekeldorf and Esrice and Barrett and, you know, all of them. Definitely, like, ones that we've seen. They've been pretty common on our stream, at least, on our end. So, yeah, between intermissions, it's always good. Like, me personally, I'm a multi-streaming kind of fella. I you know, I have, like, two tabs open simultaneously and switch between the two. That's how I like to enjoy my content as much as possible and all at once.
This song is a bop, by the way. If you guys
talk to me, where is it from?
This is Snake, the Snake Eater instrumental. It's like an arranged version just specifically for Smash. It's from Metal Gear Solid. For some reason, L and R are very hard. If you guys, can you tell me in the Twitch chat right now, because I am genuinely curious about this, what is your favorite song in all of Smash, like the entire Smash Bros., I guess, catalog? What is your favorite song?
I think me personally, I think it's really difficult to beat Route 32. Is that the one? Is that the remix that we took for, like, Black and White 2? And we're like, hey, you remember this really cool Route song? Well, we're just gonna make it sick. And that's what it is. It's just sick. It's powerful. It's strong. It just hits all the right places. That's what I'm partial to. It is Route 32, isn't it?
I'm trying to think of what my favorite is. I think it depends on the stage, I guess, but I usually start PS2 just like everyone else. So I'd say Zinnia's theme is incredible. Anyway, it looks like we're going to be getting into this next game here. We've got SHSP versus, who is it? Cookie. Cookie going Bayonetta. Not a character you typically see in the collegiate. Typically, so this matchup is rather interesting. I think it's going to be more so how is Cookie going to get SHSP in the air without the usage heel slide. If SHSP catches onto it can be a little hard for Bayonetta. Both these characters have an amazing damage output, both on each other. Got a lot of mix in them as well.
I think this is particularly interesting because Bayonetta sort of demands that you play out of shield quite a bit, and Greninja's out of shield game is definitely, you know, far from anywhere good. Maybe some of the most lackluster in this game for sure. And additionally, a lot of what Greninja's neutral relies on is jumping in with neutral, is running in with dash attack. So I kind of feel like Bayonetta in a lot of ways is just going to have to demand a completely opposite playstyle from SHSP here. Ooh.
And I've gotten word that this is actually not Cookie, this is Hikaru. That has been updated real quick. Not worried, Stream, we got you. Thank you so much for the intel. Right now, the Hikaru doing so much damage. It seems like they're very, very confident in their conversions right now, especially against Greninja. And that's really what you need as Bayonetta, especially in a matchup like Greninja, where Greninja can really blow you up for whiffing whatsoever. So, it's looking really, really crispy right now.
Yeah, I know they just, you know, SHSP just needs to find a way to get that kill complete. It needs one good down tilt, needs one good dash attack, and that could very well be the stock. Tries to go through the win box denials, but was not able to find it.
So I like that SHSP finally caught on and found out the fact that Ikaro has been using a lot of ADK in neutral. It's very, very difficult. It's pretty much one of Bayo's best tools to get startup because it catches jumps so, so well. So that dashback F smash was really, really good on their part for catching that. That being said, though, just the raw damage output from Ikaro right now is insane.
Yeah, SHSP is just struggling to get out of this advantage. Was that side B into F smash? Was that a heel slide into F smash?
Oh, yeah.
Do my eyes deceive me?
They got those.
Okay, if I was in that position, I would not expect to tech at all. Like, that looked so uncomfortable. Okay,
Caro.
It's a bit of an extension with Nair though, but not able to get much more off of it. Good use of the water shield can just sort of, you know, basically say, hey, don't approach, I'm just gonna mix up my timing a little bit, go with the tempo change.
Caro looking so aware of SHSP's disadvantage too. They've been able to react on a snap, and they haven't been really exhausting all their resources. Like, SHSP has been trying to get away in certain manners, and Caro will kind of stay within the danger zone of SHSP just to make him think that, hey, I can recover a certain way or throw out a move there, and then he'll just hit him with like an up B or a side B. Like, he's been really, really good on the coverage right here on SHSP.
SHSP seems like they're trying to force the game plan a little bit with these jump ins, and you know what? Nobody in the game calls out those jumps better than Bayonetta BB.
Wow.
She has a big long side B that just goes throughout the air. 150%, that forward throw is gonna be more than enough to kill. Ikaro did a fantastic job this game, I feel like.
F tilt into grab is like an incredible mix up right there. And I think it definitely caught SHSP off guard, because against Bayo, you get overwhelmed by the amount of damage she outputs on you. So you're like, okay, I have to air dodge. I have to find some way to get out of this combo. And Ikaro did a really, really great job of kind of mixing up his timings and just waiting for SHSP to throw something out or exhaust their resources. And that would just look like a clinic right there. So we're going to see how SHSP deals with this. I want to see them slow the game down a little bit and focus way more on waiting for Ikaro to throw out all their resources first and then get the fatty whiff part of them. So hopefully they can make that adjustment, because right now DePaul is kind of running away with this CB right now.
Yeah. Oh, they're absolutely killing it. I just think, like, I feel like everybody in the game has to play a really specific way against Bayonetta. You can kind of tell, like, whether or not, like, a person is, you know, pretty experienced in it. I think SHSP was trying to treat it like any other matchup, jumping in with Nair, trying to, you know, go in with all these forwarders and not playing nearly as grounded as they could be. And Ikaro just did a fantastic job of capitalizing on that.
Oh, definitely. So, wonder what stage you're going to go to. I feel like it really won't matter as long as you take away Bayo's really, really good stages. I think triplats are pretty good for her. Smaller stages as well, where she can access the top of the stage, is very good as well. She likes town also. I've seen a lot of Bayos that like town as well. So I feel like maybe FD, if that is not off the table, will be SHSP's best bet to kind of bring it in a little bit, because I have heard from a lot of Greninjas that they do like FD quite a bit. I'm very, very curious to see how SHSP is going to slow this next game down and maybe try to relax or just try to react a little bit better to what Ikaro is doing. Also, SDI. I feel like SDI is very, very crucial against Bayo still in trying to get out of her combos, you know, ensuring that she can't string as much damage as she would most likely like to do on you. So I hope SHSP can make those adaptations.
Yeah, you got to make sure that your SDI is, you know, like, really tight against Bayonetta. You know, what could even be worse than SDI at some point is bad SDI, which can be, like, completely reactable and just lets Bayonetta extend off of you. So if you are going to be SDIing Witch Twist shenanigans, which, by the way, you should be doing so mindfully.
Absolutely.
And understanding the situation and knowing what you're doing.
So let's see where they're going to go this time around. All right, Kalos. I think this is actually a really, really good pick for SHSP. It's pretty much another one of the FDs minus the two platforms on the side right there. But most of the action is going to be taking place center stage right here. And already seeing startup right there. Very, very unfortunate.
That's a good ninja special, baby.
Yeah.
The up smash not linking into itself. Just the way that mama used to make it. That's the bait. You really don't want to often be going off stage against Bayonetta because she can get back when you probably cannot.
She can also counter edge guard a little bit too if she reverses her.
Absolutely.
She can go in whatever direction she is facing while she does her up B. So you got to be very, very careful in case she reverses that and you're left without a jump.
He's gonna reverse edge guards are like some of the best in the game for sure.
Oh yeah.
So if you're doing so, you have to be like really, really careful with it. Really reserved. You can't. You can't go super, super deep with it.
One thing I would like to see is a little more Hydro Pump to, because Bayo's, oh wow, this could be a stock right here. Yes, it is. Really, really good catch right there from Ikaro. Yeah, I definitely want to see more Hydro Pump from SHSP because Bayonetta's recovery doesn't snap to ledge too well. She has to pretty much wait till the end of her.
No way.
I need to do it. Almost another stock right there. Ooh, if they edge guarded that properly too, that would have been scary. Yeah, Ikaro all over SHSP right now. The coverage is ridiculous. My man looking like Ryzen 5G right now.
Yeah, up tilt into the back here, extremely clean. Ikaro's looking so confident this game. SHSP just, once again, they're trying to treat this like any other matchup with these jump-ins, but nobody catches you in the air better, nobody catches your landings better than Bayonetta. But you know what Bayonetta struggles with? Walking and shielding, baby. And SHSP is not doing a whole lot of that.
That was almost really bad for SHSP though, too, trying to go off stage against Ikaro. Like, they had a good start off, it's just that Ikaro's conversions and damage output are just insane, and they know how to finish their stocks really, really nicely.
Speaking of finishing stocks, really, really clean F smash, just to close it out. Tries to go for the fair one into the up tilt, that'll have been kind of cute, but the up tilt into the up air, tries to go for another extension there. SHSP jumping out a lot in disadvantage. So close to anti-airing that.
I believe one more up tilt to back air Link is going to kill SHSP at the edge of the stage. They have to be very, very careful since Greninja is that right size and weight for it as well. You got my man SHSP has to be very careful of whatever he throws out right now because one witch time will surely end his game. That's what you kind of have to be cognizant of against Bayo. But I haven't really seen that many witch times from Ikaro this game thus far. Oh my god.
Those bats with it were so unfortunate. Imagine just being off by one frame on your punish and then dying for it.
Wow. Really, really good stuff to Ikaro right there, though. Looking very, very clean. And that was like probably some of the best Bayonetta gameplay I've like ever seen. Honestly. Just really, really clean. Managed to pick up on their conversions very, very nicely. So, so unfortunate for SHSP, though. Just missing a few confirms, you know.
I really love the way that they were antailing and catching. SHSP in general didn't know what to look out for. They didn't know which options to generally bait from Bayonetta that are exploitable. As a result, they kind of got blown up for it.
That was insane. That was so good by Ikaro right there. Very, very unfortunate right there. That was so sad. That's like the saddest thing I've ever seen. That's just unlucky. You know, you gotta make sure you're frame perfect, you're frame tight. You know, that confirm is pretty generous, but not on every character.
Not on every character, especially if they have a frame one air dodge. And with that being said, I saw a little bit of confusion in the chat about how the crew battle format, the modified crew battle format actually functions. So I thought it would be nice to give you guys a nice little refresher. So basically what's going to happen is each school comes in with 5 players and they're going to be matched up in best of threes. Every single stock that they are left with at the end of a game, assuming that they win, will be added to the total amount of points. And if they end up winning that best of three, they will automatically gain 2 points. So let's say I win game 1 with 2 stocks, I win game 2 with 1 stock, and that means I win the set. In total, I'll be taking home for my school 5 points. And that's how it works for the entirety of it.
Yes, so there is a very, very obvious slight chance that UConn is able to mount this comeback. However, they have to pretty much not drop more than I think.
They can't be dropping these. This is 16-0.
Yeah.
This is 16-0. You mean they can't drop a stock?
Oh, they can't drop anything. They literally can't drop anything.
They have
to double 3 stock.
To break even, they're going to have to double 3 stock to get those 8 points with each set. And boy, oh boy, is that, you know, difficult.
Wow. That's tough. That's going to be tough. Yeah, they have Jimbo and Almorex literally have to
play perks. As soon as they lose one stock, that's it. They can't win against the school, and they'll be strictly playing for the points. But once again, guys, it is not completely important for your school to win the set. What is most important is to rack up as many points as possible, because it is those points that will actually matter for something at the end of the season, rather than, you know, if you want it or not. So you know what? They're still not out of it. Skull Kid with the Ness up against Jimbo the Ridley. Hey, Sean, I have a question. How do you think we feel about Ness here?
For Ness Ridley, I feel great about it, honestly. There are a few things that Ness does have to watch out for, like his jumps in this matchup. He has to make sure he's not jumping over Ridley a lot of the time, as Ridley's nair and ability to catch Ness on landing are very, very strong. That being said, though, if you get one hit on Ridley, you're going to be able to tack on a bunch of damage as Ness. Ridley also dies pretty early. Like, he's at back throw percent right now. One nair or even fair offstage will take it.
Nicely timed get up attack, anticipating the yo-yo from ledge. You can't be too predictable with those ledge trap options, but really, really good use of the PK Thundu tail. Yeah. Like, compared to the actual head, it's so good at just denying recoveries and stuffing out your jumps, because it doesn't pop you up like PK Thunder does. Once again, trying to go forward, just building on all this damage, 28%, 116 in climbing. Is Skull Kid going to be able to get this juggle? Gets the flame trap with the back kick. Wow, it just doesn't stop.
Wow, this is looking like a clinic for Skull Kid right now. Jimbo just can't seem to get in whatsoever. Like, that was a zero to death. That was such a clean stock right there from Skull Kid.
Second PK fire, trying to extend it with the back air, goes through the double jump, Nera, safety up air, tries to go through the finisher, get a little swaggy with it, but you know what, Jimbo, all the way across on the other side of the stage.
Yeah, DePaul just trying to do a victory lap right now, pretty much on UConn, as they're unable to win on points at this point at all. So right now they're just playing to get as many points as they can, but right now Skull Kid popping off completely. Jimbo just couldn't get anything started right there. The punish game was so immaculate right there by Skull Kid. That was textbook Ness play right there. That was what you want to see in that matchup for sure.
So I love the fact that Skull Kid went for yo-yo up smash for all of the ledge traps.
Oh yeah.
Because even though die, because any reward is ridiculously skewed towards Skull Kid.
Yeah, for yo-yo especially, like, any other option Ridley decides to do besides get up attack will get hit by yo-yo, I'm fairly certain.
And then as soon as you can condition the new the get up attack, you shield, you get back through, and you shield, you get neutral out. It's not a good
shield,
place to be.
You get up smash maybe. Yeah, Skull Kid is insane. That was such a good punish game. I love the extensions of the conversions right there, like the drag down up airs into up tilts. Those were so, so clean. And like the PK Thunder usage was also incredible. Like that was insane. Jimbo's definitely gotta respect the amount of damage that Ness can do a little bit more and try to play a little bit more defensively. Try to use some of Ridley's more ranged moves like fair. Even bear to catch some landings and stuff like that, or just catch Ness in the air. Even neutral air when Ness jumps at you, you know. Ridley does have moves that can beat out Ness's range. You just have to use them smartly. And make sure you're not getting hit, because Ness
just don't get hit. Just don't get hit, Fivehead.
Don't get hit, Fivehead. Just don't do it.
It's not a good time.
Don't get hit.
Yeah, no, like, Ridley, honestly, is that, like, such a perfect combo weight for Ness. Ridley is the perfect size for Ness to combo to. Like, he's massive. His recoveries are linear. It's tough. Ness Ridley is just
tough. It's a rough life for Ridley. However, I do feel like Ridley does have some counterplay. So I definitely want to see some of that come out right now from Jimbo.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it all starts with not just getting the first hit from Ness, kind of letting Ness swing first on you. I feel like Jimbo was kind of committing a little bit, trying to run into.
It's all about baiting that one overly aggressive option from Ness.
Exactly.
As soon as they go through that grounded PK fire and you're at mid distance, you could be like, "All right, I'm a short hop grab you."
Right.
And once Ridley lands that down throw, it's, you know, carries you all the way off stage. Suddenly you're Ness trying to get back onto stage against Ridley's massive hitboxes that could easily, you know, like, steal your stock at a moment's notice. So, as long as, like, Ness is on top of it, you know, this is really difficult, but once Ridley gets in, he definitely gets in and stays there for quite a while.
And so I'm very, very curious to see how... Okay, so... Or you could just change your character entirely. That's fine. I think Dark Samus does a hell of a lot better against this than...
Oh, boy. Yeah. Does. Absolutely. It's. I mean, it's going from like a -2, -3 to, you know, kind of even-ish, maybe.
Potentially even maybe winning for Samus, honestly. Like, it could be... I could see arguments for both. Just given how well Samus can kind of poke Ness out, how they don't die, like, too early, how they can use projectiles. And online, I think it only gets better for characters.
Ooh,
like...
she tries to go for the early finisher. I like that attempt. We're going to be slightly punished for it. I like in a little bit earlier in the game, how Skull Kid went for extending the forward air with a neutral air, which is a lot faster than throwing out another forward air. Whole lot less committal since they were able to just get back onto the stage as well. Good with punish on that F smash. And this should be a free edge guard from here on out. Yo-Yo? Yep.
Skull Kid has done also a very, very perfect job of, like, reacting exactly to Jimbo's positioning, like, what he can and can't get away with. Like, my man has been still staying in the air and trying to threaten as many options as he can. He's been floating in with these fairs to kind of sneak in, because Jimbo's kind of just swinging, and Skull Kid is definitely getting the drop on that real quick. I feel like we have to see Jimbo pull it back just, like, a little bit, try to keep a little bit more range, because my man is definitely just trying to hit Ness, and he's leaving himself open to all of these counterattacks. You know, if you try to play overly aggressive, you're going to get swung on quite a bit.
And speaking of swung on quite a bit, Skull Kid just... piling it up. Another 3-1 stock. Is this going to be a double 3 stock?
This could be a 6 stock, and this could nail the fat 8 points that DePaul wants to see, because I believe the more points you get, the better it is for you.
That's
Jimbo finally nailing that first stock off right there. I like how he's been taking the corner a little bit. It's just so scary to do, especially against a Ness that has been having such consistent punish game this entire time. Like, his extensions have been perfect.
That attack cancel up air was so smart, because they were able to reverse the direction and be able to send them closer to stage to follow up on it a lot easier. Skull Kid, that was kind of cute.
And now Skull Kid can pretty much do whatever they want, like a back air, to get that kill right there. Just really, really solid Ness play coming up in Skull Kid right there. Jimbo, I feel like Jimbo just has to play on the defensive a little bit, you know, try to bait Ness in. You have ranged options. You have a great grab that deals with Ness catching him off guard a lot of the time. You have projectiles to be conditioning. I feel like my man was going full on normals this entire time and trying to scrap with Ness, which is not what you want to be doing all the time. I feel like you just can't scrap with Ness.
You gotta play keep away, especially if you're Samus.
Yeah.
You have all of the tools that you need just to be able. Really, really passively, and then when they weren't playing passively, they were kind of swinging at Ness.
So DePaul definitely fully running away with this crew battle. Not a single point has been tacked on the board for UConn, so we're going to see if Almirex can at least bring home some points for the boys.
Just one crumb.
Just one crumb of points, please. So we're going to see Cookie. I believe Almirex also played Bowser, I'm going to guess, because I'm pretty sure.
Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure, yeah.
So, and I remember them having two Bowsers. Mm-hmm. So I think Almirex is the other Bowser. So.
And with that being said, this is actually going to be the final match of DePaul up against University of Connecticut. A body bag. This is a slaughterhouse. DePaul is just, you know, really, really on top of it. I feel like all the players, like, consistently, they just seem so confident in the matchups that they were presented with, up against the players that they were fighting. And they, you know, they killed it 100%.
They did a fantastic job, and their play was just so solid. Their punish game was incredible. They just looked really, really good throughout the duration of this crew battle and taking the advantage over their opponent. So far, their MVP is Skull Kid, who I will say looked incredibly solid. But all their players, like, they are nailing their conversions. They weren't dropping kills. They weren't relinquishing any sort of stage control or anything like that. Just really, really, really good play coming out from DePaul. So... But we're gonna see if Almorex can have the last laugh in any way, shape, or form. But right now, it is looking mighty difficult given the how stacked this roster seems to be.
Yeah, they definitely seem like they're going to be a powerful force, coming later into the season as well. I'm excited to see how the school does up against a few others. I don't know. It just brought me a certain kind of joy just to be able to see Ness so early in the day. For those of you guys that don't know, both of us are Ness fans. We're a little bit biased in our commentary, just a little teeny tiny bit.
So DePaul actually hasn't dropped a single crew battle yet.
Really?
They have not lost. These men are only securing dubs. We do have a Palutena coming out right now. So already,
Bowser Palu, buddy. Bowser Palu.
Favorable for UConn off the bat already, but we're going to see what happens here. Cookie
you know, setting up. I already see the logs being set up. I can smell like the hot dogs, the s'mores. Because boy, oh boy. Oh, got a little camp set up.
Cookie's not trying to play any games right now with Almorex, just kind of trying to wall out, doing what Palu does best, which is just being so oppressive in terms of how you can both not get in on her and also not get away from her. Character that really, really rewards good fundies, but those fundies are rewarded in spades with just how good her punish game is and how quickly she can tack up damage. Already, we've seen so much damage getting piled onto Almorex. Oh my gosh.
Was not able to actually get the tangent angle follow-ups, but the down throw into the back here is still going to be able to clutch it out. Warp cancel schmixies. Honestly, it's really good because it just allows you to recycle the situation until your opponent gets so uncomfortable that they end up pressing something that they shouldn't, and they get hit for it. That being said, going to be whiffing the explosive flame. No punish from Almorex. Oh boy, the Palutena blender.
It seems like Cookie hasn't been going for a lot of grabs thus far, so I would like to see Almorex just try and shield more on the approaches from Cookie so far. Because Bowser up B can punish Palunair out of shield, given how it is one of her more laggier landing options in comparison to Bear and Bear. You're probably not going to be punishing those, but you can punish Nair. You can punish Nair quite
easily. Goes to the up tilt. I don't know what happened there, but that explosive flame not going to be killing quite yet. Bowser, the heaviest character in the game. The up tilt actually trading with the down beat. That interaction. Oh boy. That made me uncomfortable. I was not there for it. Double nail into down air. What was that?
It's Cookie doing Cookie's thing, man.
Oh, Cookie's at ledge against Bowser. Not a good place to be, but a good teleport cancel once again, just to be able to get down. But Almorex having none of it, saying, "You're gonna slip and slide on me? You're gonna try to schmoove? Absolutely not. You get up smash for it, silly."
All right, though, looking like Cookie's runaway game right now as Almorex is kind of struggling to find their footing a bit. They have been able to get quite a few good hits in, but I feel like they've been backing off of Cookie way too much on landing. The more space you give Palutena, the more room you give her to set up and wait for her to use her projectiles to kind of bait you towards her. Because most of the time, you probably are going to have to approach Palutena. Oh, this is looking so scary.
Yeah, Almorex being really careful with the drift when they're landing now. Not burning any of the resources, but you know what? Going to neutral, get up into the explosive flame. Still living at such an obscenely high percent. Going to be eating that back here. Waits out the down tilt. Cookie anticipating the high recovery dashes back. Not able to find it though, and that's it.
Yeah, it just seems like DePaul has such a solid group of players like at their disposal. You know, Chicago being a very, very well concentrated region in terms of skill, whereas CT, it's a little bit more scattered. It just seems like they're so consistent on their punishes. They know what exactly they have to do. They know their win conditions. They're not really dropping combos or anything like that. Their execution is looking very, very nice. Whereas UConn's players have kind of been guessing, I feel like, a little bit more.
They're picking their buttons really, really quickly. They're not just sort of giving them the time just to see what Because listen, there is no such thing as a perfect player. Every player has habits. Everybody has things that they're actively looking for. And if somebody is looking for something, they can be exploited, you know? So I think more than anything, the players from UConn could just sort of just sit back a little bit, take a couple of notes, and just see what their opponent is doing so that they could capitalize on it a bit later. Amarex was starting to clean it up in the end a little bit, but by then it was, you know, definitely a little bit too late. You know, a 2-stock deficit against Palutena. That character is slow and steady. She might not be explosive, but if she has a lead, she has a lead. And she just holds onto it for so long.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Like, once you give Palu the room she needs, it's a lot harder to deal with her, especially mm-hmm. if you're at a deficit against her. Just given at that point, she can kind of just play her game. So I don't know. Looking pretty dire for Amarex. I did see they were starting to catch on to Cookie's habits a little bit, though. So now maybe there is some hope out there for that. Though Cookie looked very, very solid. The coverage with the explosive flames were just incredible.
I would like to see them not back off as much when they're like trying to edge guard Bowser. I feel like as soon as they miss one down tilt, instead of going for another one, they just kind of like dash back and they're like, okay, well, they reset the situation there. I think they could definitely be getting a little bit more out of it. You know, just because like I feel like Bowser has one of the more exploitable recoveries in the game. It's pretty linear, it's pretty reactable. And you know, Cookie could just be a little bit tighter on the timing for sure.
So I wanted to check this in to see if it would ever happen, but the most points scored by a university so far has been 28, with St. Peter's University taking it. However, this may be the fattest lead I think I've ever seen so far, being 25-0. I don't think a lot of other schools, in fact, this might be the biggest lead ever in this league so far for Crew. So if Cookie can just nail he's already gonna nail two more points if he decides to win this game, but if he wins the game, he will tie the record, or rather if he wins the game with at least 1 stock, which he has to, he will tie the record for most points won in the Crew battle. So you know, if Cookie does this, he's breaking records, he's making history out here.
Ooh, Amarex. Again, I feel like Amarex is like, I don't know, they could definitely be like punishing some of these explosive flames a little bit quicker. Just because like I think Bowser has really, really good ground speed. He has an amazing initial dash. He can really, really get up in there. And Cookie's just getting away with whiffing some of these when it was definitely punishable at a certain point. That being said, Amarex just struggling to land against these explosive flames, but Cookie gonna overextend on shield. This is Almarex's stock to take. Tries to go through the down tilt 2-frame. Mamma mia.
The train! Yo, I think this stage pick was really, really good from Almarex. It makes landing for Palu just a little bit harder. And once you've got Palu trapped in the corner, like Bowser's ledge trapping is pretty dang good. You can react to a lot of options. He's got the coverage for sure. Like roll can be covered by up B. F tilt's also good for 2-framing. Flamethrower is amazing for recovery. Try to go near the ledge. Bowser is a ledge trapping machine. Right now, Almarex has so much momentum left on this side, despite that stock just being taken by Cookie.
Cookie pushing in a little bit too far. Still going to be snagged by that last, you know, impact landing of down air. You always got to be on the lookout for it. It's just, it's pretty exploitable, but you just always have to keep it in mind. Otherwise, you're just going to constantly get out of it. Almarex with the F tilt to clean it up. This is a little
taunt out there too. My man is still confident. He's like, yeah, my boys may have not been able to wrap it up, but I'm not gonna let you guys win cleanly over us.
Mm-hmm. Oh, good call on the jump. Not able to get that two frame either. What's happening? What a change.
Amarex seems to have found his momentum.
Just a bit of lag.
Fuck. Oh boy. This is everything for Cookie right now. If he drops this, man, that's going to be the flawless victory. Almarex going for these bears, though. It seems like he's found the momentum that he's needed to find this entire time, just given his stage control. Oh my god.
That could have definitely been it. Alva X got official boy. Oh, and that's gonna be it. Yeah. That's the game for the UConn. Let's go.
We got a point on the board for the boys. Let's go. So no records or flawless victory right now. Cookie could still tie the record for most points won in a CB, but for the most points, I'd say gapped.
Oh my goodness.
It's not going to happen. Actually, it could still happen.
Dude, such a dominating game one. Just Cookie just looks so out of the element on the stage.
Looks like a fish out of water, man. Like he just wasn't able to find his landings. He was swinging. Maybe the nerves of, oh my God, I'm about to win got to him. I don't know. So Alvarex, though, some life left in UConn still, you know? They still managed to get some. Yeah, they could almost taste it.
It was but a blemish.
Yeah, but a blemish on their perfect record. Mm-hmm. Professor gives you an A- because you're like a point off or something like that. You didn't dot your I's well enough. You're missing some commas. You use the wrong your somehow. You know, it do be like that.
Yeah.
So if I'm Alvarex, I'm feeling real good about myself. I'm like, yeah, you guys, don't worry. I got you. I got the boys. I'm holding it down. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that was kind of crazy. Alvarex kind of turned up and was like on Cookie like a heat-seeking missile. Like my man was just falling entire time so well. That was so good.
I just think like Cookie like really started overextending at the end there. I think the biggest like telltale sign of that was those dash attacks on shield, those misspaced and mistimed aerials on shield too. The last thing you want to be doing is pressing the gong buttons on Bowser's shield, because he has a nice all coverage option in the form of up B. He has a frame 6 command grab out of shield that you'll just, you know, immediately die to. It's tough, you know, it's really, really tough. So you know, you just got to make sure that your spacing and timing is really, really tight. And then you'll be good to go for game number 3.
Oh my gosh. I cannot believe how Almerix came alive that game. So that was OD. That's kind of crazy.
Kind of clutch.
It was kind of clutch. Kind of crazy. That's so cool. So, very, very curious. What is the counter pick going to be for Cookie? Because that, I feel like they like bigger stages a lot more. It seemed they were way more comfortable when they were out of range, mm-hmm. Where they could use auto reticle and explosive flame a bit better. On maps like Lylat, where the stage is a bit smaller and it's a little bit quicker for Bowser to get back, you really can't rely on those projectiles or zoning tools as well. So I'm assuming we're going to be seeing a good stage in this game. It does not have a shortage of those stages where Kylo can kind of have some room to breathe. So Almerex is going to have to do a good job banning here.
So yeah. You just, you know, you got to get rid of those biggest ones. But honestly, I feel like Ultimate does have a lot of really, really big stages. You know.
No kidding.
Listen, at the end of the day, it's Bowser power. No matter which way, like, you flip it, you know. So, I would like the chat to know something just now. Yeah. UConn took this game. Our lovely stream producer, Devin, just informed us that UConn took this game and they said, oh, we're good. We're not going to ban. We don't have any bans. We're fine. You can take us wherever you'd like.
That's either extremely defeatist or Almerex is such a chat that they don't care. It's like, yeah, I can whoop you on Lila. Let's see if I can whoop you on other stages too. But right now, Cookie
connected
a little bit so far. I feel like Bowser players are just like very, very confident sometimes. I feel like when they find their stride and when they find their momentum, they're some of the scariest players to be fighting. And we've seen it too with the likes of like Leon and a bunch of other fantastic Bowser players. That was almost a shield break already. Oh my gosh.
Amorex almost catching that jump in with the F-Tilt, goes to the down throw for a little bit of damage, gets the stage control, and is able to secure the 2-frame with the F-Tilt. Amorex, no bans, the Chad legend themselves. Ghostly the jab just to cover the spot dodge and get a little bit more damage. Really, really good choice there.
My man looking like a jock right now. He's jocking real hard. He's captain of the basketball team right now. You know, shows up. My man absolutely ripped right now. Oh my god, yeah.
Such a good punish. That was just optimal. Waited for it until the last possible second. Cookie whiffed it, jumped into it, got the grab, got the damage. Peace out.
All right, though, the down tilt back air, you know, the pilot classic. Cookie cleaned it up a little bit, saying, all right, I'm not this just yet. Albert's found something. He found some momentum. He found ways to get grabbed really, really well. He's been punishing these nairs on shields super
and punishing
well.
Those explosive flames really, really huge. Cookie has been doing them out of the corner a lot, and if you, you know, overcommit to those, you can just get yoinked off stage.
Yo, that F'd him though. Oh my god. Okay, yeah, just the grab game has been so good. Waiting for Cookie to whiff a lot of the time. Before he's able to get there. Palu does have a lot of
so scared. Oh my god, Cookie was terrified about that. Was just dashing back and forth.
Okay, catching though with the up air right there, trying to use counter, possibly to catch maybe a down B or something. That was a crazily good explosive plant placement right there. He ran into it. He got caught in his shmovement. My man got caught in the shmovement. Alright, though, try to use the up smash. It can catch recoveries below the ledge just a little bit. I know it's really catching Fox up bees and stuff like that.
That was a really unfortunate sort of event, so. There come the nail trains. 53% offstage against Palu. Gonna be missing the down tilt, though. Still caught in all the lag of explosive flame. Almanac still wants it. Really, really fishing through those landing fairs. Cookie has adapted beautifully by just going through a lot of short hop neutral eggs. That's the up go into the four up there.
Yo.
Really, really good damage.
All right, though. Cookie finding a bit of momentum here now. Catching. I love how the explosive flame forced the landing right there from Almarex. This could look pretty. This is looking pretty dire for Almarex. It looks like the wind has been ripped out of their sails. Oh, the miss in there right there. This gives Almarex the stage he needs. He has a giant F smash. It would have killed, but like, why?
Oh my goodness.
Why would you go for F smash? For those of you who don't know, if you do charge a smash attack, if you get caught hit doing it, it actually multiplies how far you get sent just a little bit.
Oh, really?
So
that's
I'm
the information for me. Are you serious?
I'm pretty sure that's how it works. It may have been changed in this game, but I'm pretty sure that's how it works.
Interesting.
So that my man kind of just did himself in a little bit.
And never it was indeed. Cookie just cleaning it up at the end there. Give us a little bit of hope at the end, huh?
Almarex went from Chad to sad. That was so unfortunate right there, but Paul gonna be cleaning it up really, really nicely against Yukong, not dropping a single set that entire crew battle.
25-1 25-1
28-1
28-1
that ties them with St. Peter's, and I believe they now have the record for biggest lead ever in this crew. Yeah.
That's kind of crazy.
That's a 27 point difference. I don't see any other crews with that. So yeah, congrats to DePaul for now setting records here. You know, that is still monumental. So tied for most points gained in the movie and has the biggest point differential right now. So you know, breaking records and tying
breaking records.
It's the best you can hope for.
Mm-hmm.
So good stuff right there.
And with that being said, that concludes DePaul University up against the University of Connecticut. And just as you said, one of the most massive leads, if not the most massive lead we've seen all season so far. Just wanted to first of all say thank you to everybody from both universities that came out to support the boys. Honestly, I do love seeing all like the college fellas come out every single week, you know, come out and support, you know, look at nice little bit of camaraderie. It's cute. we got to do a couple of little shout outs and like just a couple of informational things. So number one, normally we would be seeing Georgetown University up against the University of Colorado now, but alas, there was a forfeit. I believe Georgetown forfeited and Colorado took the dub. So the remaining matches for tonight will be St. John University up against Wichita. And then a little bit later, we'll be seeing Quinnipiac up against Fairfield University. On the first stream at twitch.tv/officialEGF, they have plenty of more schools happening if you want to be checking out that action. I don't know if we're going to be jumping into the next school right now or we're going to be waiting until 7:30. So what's the sauce? Okay. Gotcha. Okay. So we're going to be going off air. We're going to be coming on at 7:30 again. Until then, we are going to be hosting official EGF. So I guess we should do a shout out, Sean. First and foremost, you should be following my co-caster on Twitter, at Fan9S. You could also follow him on Twitch, twitch.tv/Fan9S. You should be following both EGF SSBU and official EGF. Costs nothing to hit the nice, delicious follow button. And then you should be following our lovely stream producer, House of 3000. They're killing it, one of the most premier tri-state broadcasting orgs. They do so much for the work here. They are responsible for making the tri-state smash scene, especially in New York, what it is today. And then if you'd like, you don't have to, you could follow me, but my tweets are really bad. So I don't recommend doing that for your own mental health.
You covered that pretty well, I'd say. The only other thing I have left to plug really is my YouTube channel, youtube.com/fangplays. If you guys are curious to see who the best player of each character in Smash Ultimate is, I've got a great series there posted up for you guys there. So go check that out if you want. Follow all the people that are plugging their Twitters right now in Twitch chat because I see it. You know, I respect the grind. Keep hustling out there. And yeah, so we'll see you guys for the next block. Thank you for coming out. Thank you for everyone who supported their boys and gals for these collegiates. My name is Fan9S. Stay salty, everybody.